Thank you, Edgar, for the introduction. What I'm going to do, though, Edgar, is actually talk in a slightly more narrow way about some of the work that we've been doing at LSE Cities around this conference, and obviously begin to make some speculations about the issues that you're talking about, relating some of the trends in social change and urbanization and health to do with design and the physical world, and in particular to do with density and sort of compaction, and what effect that has on the individuals who live there. This is work which I've already alluded to has been led by Mifanri Taylor and other colleagues here at the LSE, but very closely done together with colleagues from different departments from Hong Kong University, and all their names and their work is acknowledged in the report. What we did is really began to say what is happening behind these big statistics. We've just had a session where big issues of macro areas which we can't even conceive of in India or China are beginning to grow. And of course this is depicted in this diagram of the world as it urbanizes, and all you need to see from wherever you are in the room is where the white areas are, show you where growth has happened in the last 20, 25 years or so, and in the dark green where urban growth is going to happen according to the UN in the next 20 odd years. And it's very clear where that is going to be. It's going to be in the areas that Juan Clos was referring to today, where there's a very dramatic shift in the way the economy is working. It's tending to be in areas like Africa, parts of Asia, where growth and urbanization is actually not necessarily happening with jobs at the same time, and certainly not industrialization or manufacturing. So that raises a whole series of important issues. So what we've wanted to do, very much in the spirit of the work that we've done at LSE Urban Age for a last number of years, is understand what shape, what form does this growth take, and what effect does it have on individuals, and particularly begin to ask the question about the impact, not just on social inequality, but on health inequalities. Now, this is an endless, infinite city. It's 22 million people, it's Mexico City, and it never ends. And this is one way of making city. So we have to be careful here. We're not talking about one uniform type, one uniform morphology of city, because this is another way of making city. It's a city of enormous density. It's one of the densest in the world. And it's obviously Hong Kong. This happens to be a part of the city very close to here, Wan Chai. So the question for us is, what difference do these environments actually make to the way we live? It's not just a question of the size, it's also a question of the speed and the pace of change, because the provision of many of the facilities which have even been talked about today, let alone health ones, have to be put into a context when you think of it over time. This shows you the numbers in growth per hour. Well known, perhaps, that in places like Lagos or Mumbai, we're talking about 40, 50 people moving into these cities or being born in these cities per hour. That's one every minute and a half that I speak, a new person moving in. But cities like Hong Kong are still growing, not as much, of course, as they used to, something like 7. But put that into the context of London, which is one person per hour, that you begin to understand how the system works. So the provision of facilities and the shape of the city is exactly the center of the research that we've done. But there's some basic elements that we need to understand. The issue of age was referred to already this morning by Dr. Chow and by other representatives of Hong Kong. But of course, it's a global situation. If you look at what has been happening in the last 40 or 50 years, basically people's life expectancy has increased, with the enormous exception, of course, of Africa, perhaps strongly influenced by the spread of AIDS over the last years. But it's not just a question that life expectancy has improved for a whole series of reasons that we can understand, but it's also a question of what's happening at the other end of the scale in terms of children and child mortality. And even there, and particularly, and it was talked about this morning by Dr. Chow, what has happened in the case of Hong Kong is that child mortality has dropped very dramatically in a short space of time. But it's very different in very different parts of this city, and we'll come to that in a moment. So what we did with our team is to try and remap, effectively, to try and understand what are the health patterns, but also what are the education patterns, and what are the wealth patterns in 129 metropolitan areas around the world. Some of this data, of course, is available. Many of you will know it at the level of the nation. You will know that, you know, the UK and the United States compare in certain ways. What we tend not to know yet is how different metropolitan areas, not just different cities, but extended metropolitan areas actually compare. And what you see here, and it's shown in great detail in the report, is the darker green are basically areas that perform better in terms of a whole combination of health indices, which are to do with life expectancy and child mortality. And the numbers you hear, are the actual life expectancy. And what you see is that the red areas, the orange areas, are at the worst end of the scale, not surprisingly given where they are. But there are differences. There are regional differences, and we heard Athar earlier talk about the regional inequalities that are beginning to show up in areas like China, of course, in India. And just look at the differences in terms of life expectancy, even though we accept that life expectancy in and of itself is not the only criteria that matters, between Ho Chi Minh City and Hong Kong. These differences exist between Paris, which has a similar life expectancy to Hong Kong, and say Bucharest or Moscow or elsewhere, clearly in Africa, but even in the United States and the whole of Africa, do you see these enormous differences relatively close by. Hence, this distribution of life expectancy, which is really quite different with African cities way down there, Johannesburg, average age today, 51, mainly because of AIDS. I mean, this is a shocking difference. And I'll come back to the fact that these differences, what you find at a regional level, you also find within cities themselves. And that is an important component. In fact, this has been said, it was talked about in the first session, so I can be very quick about it. London, the city I inhabit, with many of us take part in many ways, has a rich and well-off West and a pretty messy, not necessarily just poor, but pretty messy East London. This is what in this index of deprivation, which shows low education, unemployment, and a whole series of other factors, looks. And basically, most of East London, if central London is over there, is more problematic with respect to West London. And here's the famous diagram. If you take the underground line in Westminster, it's been talked about, you basically you lose a year on average as you go east. Now, importantly, and linking to a session tomorrow, it's over here, it's in this part of London, that £9.3 billion of public money is being spent on the London Olympics. And of course, this is very much Stephen O'Brien's sort of territory that he was referring to before. Now, in the report, you will see this listing in many ways of the three factors. Now, I don't want to in any way either go into this in detail or say that this is it. The point that this is a starting point for research which goes underneath the skin of the cities. At one level, we've looked at in the cities here on the left, the nation, the population. We've looked at health, education, and wealth, all three parameters. It's quite interesting to see what the correlations are between one and the other. And clearly, education, health, and wealth are connected, particularly at the top end of the scale. But what is intriguing is that it's the high-income Asian cities which perform pretty remarkably if you look at it at this scale. Some European cities, with London, in fact, at the bottom, come next. And actually, the North American cities, which figure at the top, come certainly third. So that is quite interesting. But what's happening inside the cities is where I want to go in a moment. But what we have found, that out of the 129 cities, over 90%, growing up in a city is better for you than growing up outside a city. We found in places like Mumbai, for example, that the chances of living longer, getting better education, and having access to services is considerably higher than elsewhere. And I think this is an issue that needs to be understood and discussed. So what does this mean in terms of the work that we've been able to do with HKU and our colleagues there in this city? Well, what we were able to do, and this is what I challenged Dr. Chow with before, is to actually map some of the data which is actually available. What we've also heard today through Christine Lowe is, well, the data is here. It's a very sophisticated country in terms and city-state in terms of information available, but how is it used politically to actually affect change? Well, the first thing we did is that we simply mapped the social inequalities. In the darker colors, you see sort of lower income groups. Sorry, in the purple colors, you see lower income, And you see Hong Kong Island here to trace you, Kowloon and Shenzhen up at the top. You see that there is a marked pattern, as you would tend to expect everywhere. If you did this in Chicago, you would have one area south, which would be one color, and another area north, which would be another. That was something we heard about Lo Prado today. East and west was very, very different. Here it's like pockmarked. You have areas of intense wealth and areas of intense poverty, one next to each other. As Klaus said earlier, so what? You expect that. What the so what is what actually happens when you translate this into health inequalities. It's a one-to-one correlation, you'd call that. We looked at premature mortality. That means people who die before the age of 75. Of course, in a city where you tend to live to over 80, that's significant. And there's some areas which clearly are problematic. And if you look at child mortality, despite the fact that in the city it's dropped so dramatically, it's one of the best in the world, what actually happens is that in some areas, you have nearly twice the probability, 1.6 to be precise, of actually dying as a child than you do in other areas. So how does a government actually introduce policies which make a change? Well, one of the issues that needs to be understood, and we spent a lot of time focusing on here in Hong Kong, particularly with Joshua Bolshover and his colleagues at the Department of Architecture, was the density issue. There are cultural dimensions to this that we heard in the last debate, which weren't, I think, followed up perhaps as much as they could be. There are cultural issues of how you live in different areas. But I think even there, you can't assume that everything's okay and that there isn't perhaps a limit in terms of the way that you actually live. So this is New York, for example. This is perhaps an unfair picture of the densities of Hong Kong. But that's what you see when you get off an airplane and it shocks you. We tend to look at the urban age at density in different ways. This happens to be London, shown at a certain density, at exactly the same scale. That's what happens in New York, and this is what your city is like. So the densities are a factor of 3 or 4 times higher. But that density, of course, makes it one of the most sustainable cities in the world. It has a fantastic system of public transport. So what we then did in working with other colleagues and other departments here at HKU was to work very closely and understanding what people actually think. We went to ask a series of residents, young, middle-aged, and older, how do they feel living in some of the densest areas of the city? And these are some of the answers, some of the questions. I think we have best transport here. I moved into the area just because of this, as one of the residents. Another one says, although Hong Kong is dense, it is still convenient. The notion of convenience is a big issue, that you actually, in a way, compromise certain things that in other countries and other cultures we think are perhaps more important. Here, there's a trade-off in terms of convenience. If you can be within 10 minutes of work, that's a good thing, because that, in many ways, is what you want to value. We don't have to spend a long time traveling to the destination. Amenity-wise, it's good enough. So obviously, that is one of the byproducts of that density. Now, if you look at this, without going into detail at all, it is quite extraordinary if you compare how people move, what we call in the trade, modal splits. In Hong Kong, there we go, nearly 93% of all daily trips are either taken by walking or taking one form of public transport. That's a fantastically high figure. We'd be so pleased if in London or New York we actually got anywhere near there. In fact, it's only the really low sort of developing economies of, say, Mumbai, which actually perform anything like that. That's because people are living in slums and cross the road to go to work. It's a completely different economy, and we need to understand that. And let's not forget that in a place like Sao Paulo, you have commuting times of over 4 or 5 hours. What happens is that the rich therefore find other ways of getting around. Now, this is instead a statement of what someone says living in one of the dense areas here. Time matters in Hong Kong, but not only for the rich. So you have actually a system which is designed in a very different way. So we looked at these three areas of greater density, which some of you will recognize, both in Kowloon and Hong Kong Island, and asked a few questions. This is where I'm going to wind up, Edgar. It was interesting to hear from these questions, and these were not people that we chose who were already unhappy or unfortunate. It was really across the board. So for us, it's a new work which tries to get at the skin, the qualitative dimension perhaps that Richard Sennett was talking about before. We got these sort of statements about actually what's it like to live in areas like this. And clearly the issue of air quality becomes incredibly significant here. The air quality is not so good, and I always cough. You know, when you see pictures like this of what actually happens, simply because everyone has got an air conditioning unit on, it blows hot air into the next one. So you have to put on your air conditioning unit even if you didn't need to have it. So proximity has its own effects. This is, of course, incredibly dramatic. And it is not just a cultural issue, it's a land value issue. If land is so high, you can only afford a space which is as big as four times of this lectern where I'm standing. You can touch the flat next to yours if you reach out your hands, is one of the comments made by there. And you know, this in Kowloon is representative of it. Now, as I conclude, I think probably this statement by one of the residents in Sai Ying Pun says more than anything else. I'll read it out. "I wasn't experienced. I was so happy that I invited my colleagues to my home. The gross floor air was merely 300 feet. It was so cramped that everyone sat in rows as if they were at the cinema. They said I had overestimated myself. Since then, I've never invited anyone to my home." Now, think of this impact in terms of the psychology and the relationships you have with others. And I know Mazda Adni will talk about the impacts of density and form on well-being at that level. Therefore, and I would say these would be some of the concluding remarks that we take with us, relating very much to the question, Edgar, you raised of design and public space, is that this matters even more in a dense city. What happens outside, how you can use the outside for the social competence that Richard was talking about becomes very, very important, particularly where you have an older or a younger population, as we've seen here. Now, Paul Yip, who collaborated and is here and will be speaking tomorrow, made this very simple point. The success of a city cannot be measured only by its financial prowess. The mental health and the well-being of its residents must also be considered. I think in the research that we've done together, some of these themes are beginning to become clear. Is there a limit to density? Probably, actually, there is. Is it happening in Hong Kong? Possibly, and particularly for the new immigrants who are coming, and many of us saw the conditions that they are living in now. This means that perhaps one needs to reconsider planning policies and putting design at the center of that and not at the margins of it. And in that sense, I think we need to really understand how design and particularly public space makes a difference in making healthy cities. Thank you very much.